Bruce DuMont back in hour number two of Beyond the Beltway, and Patrick Hanley and Stephanie Hitt join me in studio, WIND in Chicago, and joining us via Zoom for this hour of the broadcast is Matthew Sorens. He is U.S. Director of Church Mobilization and Advocacy with World Relief. That is one of the leading relief refugee agencies in the world, and he joins us because there has been so much said, written, and we've all watched the horrible stories of what's been happening with the women and children fleeing Ukraine, and we thought that we would invite Matthew back to share sort of what's going on and if there's some things that those living in the United States can do to help this worldwide situation. But Matthew, let me begin by talking about, obviously, there are many relief agencies in the world. World Relief is one of the largest. How are things coordinated with all of the social refugee organizations in the world so you're not bumping into each other?
Yeah, it's a great question, Bruce, and thanks for the opportunity to be with you all. There's obviously there's various ways that we're responding to this situation, both in terms of the possibility of resettlement of refugees to the United States, but also the immediate humanitarian response that's within Ukraine and then, of course, within the bordering countries in Europe. You know, speaking at least for World Relief, we work through a coalition called the Integral Alliance of like-minded organizations that partner together to say, how can we best pool the limited resources that we have and work with local partners on the ground? So in many cases, in the crisis in Ukraine and even in Poland and elsewhere, it's local churches, community organizations, to do our best to communicate. Obviously, that's challenging in a crisis situation to coordinate everything all at once. But it is, you know, it's an important opportunity for the world to come together. And then the people here in the United States obviously have a key role in that as well. And that's even before we get to the question of Ukrainians arriving here to the United States, which is certainly a possibility as well.
And because yours is more of an evangelical Protestant organization, if I have read it correctly, and the fact that those residing in Ukraine and even in Poland might tend to be Roman Catholic, is there any denominational division or subdivisions that set up when you're dealing across religious lines?
Yeah, you know, it's a good question. We are an evangelical Christian organization, and that certainly motivates the work that we do. You know, I think that the motivation we have would be something we would share with Roman Catholics or Orthodox Christians or other Christian groups, certainly, as well. It's a similar, rooted in the scriptures, the Christian scriptures. But we do serve people regardless of their background, whether they're Christian or of a different faith tradition and whatever kind of Christian they may be. Obviously, with Ukraine, it's primarily a Christian population, but there are minority Protestant populations. There's Orthodox, many Orthodox as well. There's people who don't have any faith, but we serve them in all the same ways. And even though we're often working through local churches.
What are you doing right now in Ukraine and Poland and Romania and Moldova and some of the countries that have been incoming to refugees from Ukraine?
Yeah, so World Relief's work there is through local partners and as well as some international partners as well, because frankly, most relief and development organizations weren't on the ground in Europe prior to this crisis, but we found a few that were, as well as local organizations, churches included. So it's really a basic humanitarian response. So providing people with food, providing people with cash assistance, especially sometimes just transportation assistance, because the first country they reach may not be where they intend to stay. And also just connecting people to a warm reception. They've gone through, as we've all seen, just a horrific situation that they've had to flee.
And it now, is on these borders, let's say with Poland, there are many cities in Poland that are accepting the refugees. Is that correct? It isn't.
Yeah,
just,
really.
They're not all going through one turnstile. There's many cities.
That's correct. And they're going to various countries as well, really, throughout all the countries surrounding that.
And when they arrive there, okay, so they cross the border. Are there local border guards, Polish border guards, that check them in? Do they welcome them in open-minded without any questions at all? Or how quickly does their processing begin to some extent?
Yeah, I mean, there's some element of processing. They're checking people, especially for Ukrainian nationals. So one of the challenges we have seen early on was you have people fleeing from Ukraine who are not actually Ukrainians. People who are migrants from other parts of the world who are residing in Ukraine. Some of them initially had some trouble getting across, but from what I've been told and from my understanding, that's been resolved largely, and people mm-hmm. are able to get out who need to get out. Again, this is largely women and children, and for the most part, men are not, you know, of a certain age or being expected to stay in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's some processing, and of course, there's just a lot of people to process, but the Polish government, along with the other EU countries, have generally been very open to those fleeing from Ukraine. I think there's a great deal of solidarity. Understanding, frankly, that the threat that they're fleeing is a potential threat to Poland and to other countries as well. And there's a real eagerness to stand in solidarity with the people who are making the difficult decision to flee.
Once someone gets into a country, whether it's a receiving country, whether it's Poland or Romania, how long generally do they stay at the border, at this receiving center, that there may be tents that are set up or certainly temporary living conditions. How long do they generally stay there before they are on a bus or train going inward someplace else in Europe or even being driven by individuals in their cars?
I mean, I think it's difficult to speak of what generally happens because this is, you know, the situation has been happening for a month. And right. So it's different than a lot of other refugee crises, mm-hmm. frankly, just in terms of the scope. I mean, it's not unprecedented to have 3.5 million people flee a country, but it is, to my knowledge, in 3 or 3.5 weeks to have so many people leaving. Right. You know, I can't speak specifically to how long people are staying. I know some people are staying relatively close to the border with the hope that this will be a short-term situation and they'll be able to go back quickly. Mm-hmm. Others are maybe less optimistic and are, you know, immediately moving forward, hoping to get to Germany or to France or to the United Kingdom and to, you know, put down roots in a new place and find work and be able to support themselves. And most of the European countries have been fairly accommodating in terms of offering a temporary legal protection.
So some processing and some services provided in Ukraine before someone gets outside of Ukraine? They're so being we're working on the buffer zone there.
We're working with partners who are there in Western Ukraine as well mm-hmm. as in some of the surrounding countries. Mm-hmm. So it's not World Relief staff, but we're able to help work with partners who are on the ground.
Okay. We have guests here in Chicago. I think they have a question or comment. And Patrick Hanley, we'll let you start.
Yeah, sure. Matt, thank you so much for joining us tonight and for the work that you do. It's such an important component to this crisis. So I just want to share my appreciation to you. And I'm curious, in the communities that you've worked with in the past, are there kind of best case studies, best practices of communities in either the United States or elsewhere that have really done a good job welcoming and resettling refugees? And if so, what have they done that's different?
Yeah, no, I appreciate that question, Patrick. I mean, so World Relief has been resettling refugees here in the United States since the late 1970s. So we've seen, you know, our program started with the Vietnamese. Mm-hmm. We've seen groups of refugees from various countries, various parts of the world.
Matt, I'm going to interrupt you right now. We do have to pause for a break. When we come back, we'll pick up with your answer to the question. I'm Bruce DuMont, along with Stephanie Hitt and Patrick Hanley, tonight on Beyond the Beltway. Bruce DuMont back. We continue with Matt Sorens from World Relief. And Matt, you were in the middle of an answer when we had to break for the spot. So go ahead.
Yeah, you know, I would say our experience, and we've resettled at World Relief about 300,000 refugees since the late 1970s. So we've had, you know, a lot of experience with this, including a lot from Ukraine, actually. More than 7,000 Ukrainians just in the last decade have come through World Relief to our offices around the country. Consistently, I think, you know, there's a lot of needs when refugees first arrive, but one of the things we've found is often a need is just friendship, which is probably fairly obvious to anyone who has ever had to leave home and be all by themselves in a new place. So one of the things we do at World Relief is we want to bring together teams of volunteers to surround families. You know, if they want that, it's up to them, and they almost always do, who will walk with them through the adjustment of life in a new culture, learning a new language in most cases. You know, the World Relief staff is there to help with those things as well, but a team from a local church or community organization can come alongside in a closer relational way. And we found that that's an important sort of best practice, is to make sure people are connected relationally as they arrive in a new place.
In the United States, what regions of the country or states within the United States have the record of accepting the most Ukrainians in the past? Where have they gone in the past?
In the recent past, most Ukrainians who've come in the last decade have come in through a program that is a program that goes back to like the kind of the Cold War era that prioritizes religious minorities. So it's a lot of evangelical Christians and Jewish refugees who've generally qualified under that program. It's called the Lautenberg Amendment. Mm-hmm. Most of those folks have gone into California and Washington, at least within our network. So Sacramento is a huge hub for the Slavic community, Spokane, Seattle, Washington as well, which is where, as we expect to begin to see more Ukrainians arrive post this new invasion from Russia, we would anticipate that a lot of that will be family reunification, and that will end up going to some of those same communities. But here in Chicagoland, we also have a pretty large, significant number of Ukrainians who've been resettled as well.
And those that are coming, are they primarily farmers? Are they white collar workers? What are the educational skills? And again, most of the people that are coming now are women and children. They may or may not have a professional contingent to them. But, I mean, if their husbands, finish this war at some point, they will want to rejoin them, I would think. Either rejoin them back in Ukraine or rejoin them in Seattle or Spokane.
Yeah, I should be clear. At this point, I mean, we've been resettling Ukrainians for many years, but actually it was halted with the invasion of Russia. The people who were anticipating arriving this month have not arrived.
Okay.
Just last week, a few days ago, President Biden announced that there's going to be a large number of Ukrainians resettled to the U.S., but we haven't gotten a lot of details on who those people are, when they'll be arriving, precisely where they'll be arriving. We do anticipate it will significantly be family reunification. Yeah. So
I think he said 100,000.
Right. That's the number he said, and we don't know exactly the details on, again, if those all come in through the formal refugee resettlement program, or that could include other legal avenues to come to the United States as well. But we're waiting on some details while also preparing to be able to receive people. And I should say, we have a lot of those Ukrainians who've come in the past who are desperate for their loved ones, and frankly, a number on our staff who are really concerned about loved ones in Ukraine. Most Ukrainians, frankly, probably don't want to come to the United States. I mean, they want to go back to Ukraine. That would be the first choice. But the longer this goes on, and especially for those who already have relatives in California or in Illinois or in Washington State, coming to the U.S. may be the most, the best option for them. And we are eager to see the U.S. government make that option available.
Insofar as where government funds might go, it would seem to me that either Poland or Romania or Moldova even the Slavic nations would be most likely places. Are there special things that you know that the U.S. government has already set up in those countries to alleviate the pressure on their economies? I know this is a little far afield of what you do, but I'm just historically, if Romania needs some help, are they getting some help from the United States at the moment?
Yeah, I mean, that was part of the announcement that President Biden made this past week, along with the announcement of the refugees coming to the United States, was a significant amount of funding that the U.S. will be sending both to Ukraine, but also to some of those neighboring countries. Yeah, I mean, a country like Moldova is among the poorest countries in Europe, and it is, long term, it may actually benefit them if they have some new people feeding into the economy. Historically, refugees actually are an economic benefit to the country that receives them. But in the short term, it can be a lot of stress on the place that's receiving them, especially when there's so many coming all at once.
Stephanie Hitt's got a question for you.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you touched on some of this, and that is, do you anticipate, our government increasing the number of people? I know Biden mentioned 100,000 people. And how many people do you really think will take advantage of that? Because, the experience is, we have Ukrainian village, our family has some very close Ukrainian friends as well. And many of the stories we've heard are of people who have gone to Germany and Poland to help their family get out. And many of them want to stay nearby. They don't want to come back to the U.S. You know, they don't want to come to the U.S. because I think there is that feeling of, you know, I want to go home at some point. So do you anticipate that full 100,000 being used and needing more, or do you really see the resettlement efforts are going to be focused in predominantly in Europe?
Yeah, I think certainly the vast majority of refugees fleeing right now will stay in Europe. But that would be true even if 100,000 out of 3.5 or 4 million did come to the United States. You know, precisely the number, you know, no one will be made to come to the United States. That would be an option that might be given to people. It's hard for me to predict, you know, will there be exactly 100,000 who want that option or more or less who would want it or less? I also think this is a somewhat unique refugee situation in that people have a relatively well-off, safe place to flee to in a neighboring context. I mean, we also serve refugees who fled other contexts where there wasn't. I mean, frankly, the Afghans who, you know, we've been serving just in the last 7 or 8 months, that's almost moved out of the headlines, but that's still a very urgent situation. And the neighboring countries there are not necessarily great places for those fleeing the persecution under the Taliban to flee to. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, go back several years, the Syrian crisis, which was fleeing literally some of the same missiles from the Russian government that people in Ukraine are now fleeing. Mm-hmm. You know, Jordan has received a large number of people, so has Turkey, so has Lebanon, but they're often in pretty desperate camp settings. And those are under, you know, low income countries or moderate income countries that mm-hmm. don't have a lot of resources to care for a very large number of people. So our hope is that this allows Ukrainians to come as, you know, as that makes sense, especially for family reunification or anyone who might not be able to safely go back home, whenever that becomes an option. We hope it's soon. But also that it would help rebuild the refugee resettlement program for those fleeing other conflicts who may have been in a camp setting for 5, 10, sometimes. And we've served people who've sat in a refugee camp for 20 or 25 years in many cases.
Wow. So how quickly are you seeing people, at least in the Ukrainian crisis, how quickly are they getting across the border and spending time before they move on to another location? Is it a matter of days? Are people moving through pretty quickly?
I mean, in terms of other locations, like within the EU, some people are able to move relatively quickly. Again, to be clear, I'm not aware that almost anyone has come, at least formally as a refugee, to the United States. Some who might have a tourist visa are able to get on an airplane and come and then potentially seek asylum when they get to the United States, or they may, you know, want to just, you know, usually tourist visa gets 6 months here. That might be enough for some people and hope to be able to go back. We've even seen people flying to Mexico and seeking asylum at the U.S.-Mexico border. Because that they had a visa to get to Mexico, they didn't have a visa to get to the United States, but that was a, you know, a possibility to try to get to safety. Yeah. But the resettlement program usually is a long-term operation. It's not, the Afghan situation was very unique with the evacuation that happened there, but in general, people are resettled to the United States as refugees years, not months or weeks after they flee an initial crisis.
We have a call from Ben in El Paso, Texas, listening to us on KTSM. Go ahead, you're on the air, Ben. Hello. Ben, are you there?
Can you hear me?
Go ahead.
You hear me?
Yes. Go ahead, Ben.
Okay. We're going to tell you, our president says we're going to take in 100,000 Ukrainians.
Yes.
Okay. I've got a lot of people in my city. I've seen pictures in New York City. I'm sure it's all throughout the land of our country. There's plenty of American citizens that are in food lines because they can't because of inflation is going to makes it where they don't have any food, and so we're going to spend how much money in order to settle these people in our country, and then also you know, if we spend the money, we don't have the money, we just have to print it up, which adds to inflation. So you know, you bring the Ukrainians in to the United States, then what? Just like the same way that you bring the people in from Mexico.
Okay, take a breath now. Relax. I'm going to let Matt tackle this because I'm sure he has heard it. I know doing a talk show, this is a lament that I hear periodically. How much can the United States do? When is enough enough? And you know, what about those in the United States that might need some of these tender, loving care services that are being provided by World Relief? Matt?
Yeah, you know, the interesting thing is if you talk to economists, most of them actually think that taking more refugees would actually be in the long-term economic interests of the United States. A couple of economists at Notre Dame did a study a few years back and found that 20 years after arrival, the average refugee adult has paid in more than $21,000 more in taxes at all levels, federal, state, and local, than the combined cost of governmental expenditures on their behalf. So including the cost for initial resettlement, any public benefits that they've qualified for over those 20 years. So there are some upfront costs associated with this, but it's probably in our long-term economic interests. I mean, to be clear, at World Relief, we're a Christian organization. We want to welcome people because we believe that they're made in the image of God, their lives have value, and they're worth protecting as they're fleeing a truly horrific situation, whether that's in Ukraine or Syria or Afghanistan or wherever. But frankly, it's precisely because we think that these are people made in the image of the Creator God that they also have potential to create and to contribute. And
when we come back, Ben, are you still on the line?
Yes, I am. Yes.
Stay on the line. We're going to talk to you when we come back. I'm Bruce DuMont. Bruce DuMont back, and Matt Sorens, we're going to have a moment and let everybody hear a little bit about your background. Tell us a little bit where you're from and what are you up to? We know that you're with the World Relief, but give us your background and what was it about that work that you chose to make it your life's work?
Yeah, you know, I grew up in Wisconsin, a little, small city about 3 hours north of Chicago, and came down to the Chicagoland area to go to Wheaton College. And while there, I did a 6-month internship with World Relief in Nicaragua. So mm-hmm. World Relief's got operations all over the world, all with the same mission of empowering local churches to serve the vulnerable. But you know who the vulnerable are in any given context mm-hmm. varies. I came back from that 6 months in Nicaragua and really enjoyed the time and really appreciated the mission of the organization. So I applied for a job with our office in Wheaton, Illinois at the time. And that was almost 17 years ago now. So I've been at the organization quite a while. And in the U.S., including in the Chicagoland, in three locations, we primarily are focused on serving refugees and other immigrants. So that's what I've done first with doing legal services and then working primarily with church partners and some policy issues for the last number of years.
Okay, thanks very much. Stephanie Hitt, give us the brief version of who you are.
Oh, I'm Stephanie Head, and I am a Republican activist, and I am currently serving as the chief advisor for a newly announced Senate U.S. Senate candidate, Kathy Salvey, who will be running as a Republican here in Illinois.
Okay, and Patrick Hanley.
Sure, I'm a businessman living in Winnetka, Illinois, working at a company called Piglet in Bed. We sell linen bedding, pajamas, homeware, sleepwear, that sort of thing.
Okay. Ben, are you still on the phone?
I sure am.
Okay, now Ben is calling us from El Paso, Texas. He called in the last segment and said, why are we spending so much effort on dealing with refugees and immigration issues when we have many people in the United States who are needy and are being ignored? At least that's in your view. Matt gave an answer to that question, talking about the biblical spirit upon which he acts and that you know, Christianity and religions of the world feel that there is a need and a responsibility to help those who are less fortunate than they are. And I wanted to get your reaction, because your reaction is one we hear frequently on talk radio, that take care of ourselves, forget about everybody else. But how do you react when you hear Matt's response? I don't know whether you're a religious man or not, but is there something to Matt's answer that that you agree with?
No. You take care of your own people first. And unfortunately, you know, if we were one of the strongest nations, we had the best economics in the world, economy in the world, and everything else. Then fine. You know, if we had the money, you know, I give it to them.
Don't
but
we have
we don't
that?
Have the money.
Don't we have that?
No. Why do you think there's so much inflation right now? We're $123 trillion in debt because of all the things that the banks have done over the last number of years and everything.
Okay.
We are, the U.S. dollar is under attack. we're no longer going to be the reserve currency. And besides that, Ben, we're going to end up having a digital programmable dollar.
Ben, do you also agree? Ben, let me just ask you this. Do you also agree that the United States should not be responding with any military hardware to help the Ukrainians? Is that a waste of money as well?
I believe that what we're doing in Ukraine is all a part of bringing down the United States of America and our economy.
Why do you think that, Ben?
Because Ukraine has more grain, and they supply 15-20% of the grain in the world. Russia provides a lot of the grain. Russia also provides a lot of European oil, and it's a matter that the reason why we're going to have food shortages is because Russia also supplies fertilizer and everything. Everything is being brought to bear on the United States, so we will go bankrupt with the third world countries.
And it's your position, and then we're going to move on. It's your position that a very rich nation, you challenge whether we're the richest of the rich, but it's generally your feeling is that if there's someone that is stumbling and needs help, it's your position not to help them.
If we were the richest nation in the world, yes, I think we should help them. We are not the richest nation in the world. We are bankrupt. Our dollar is gone.
Are you? What religion do you practice, if I may ask?
I believe in God.
You believe in God?
I believe in.
Now, my question to you is, Matt, let me ask you, because you are a man of God. You're not a minister, but you obviously, it's the biblical teachings that really are the basis of your organization and your life's work. Speak to Ben and see if there's any common ground with Ben's position.
Yeah, you know, I don't want to presume that everyone shares the same faith background that I do, but for us at World Relief, certainly our motivation is our Christian faith and the command to do to others as we would have them do to us. And the reality is, I live in a different part of the United States than I do geographically, certainly, than Ben does. So even having spent a lot of time in El Paso, you know, I think this is actually the richest country on earth, maybe not per capita, but at least in terms of overall wealth. We've been an incredibly blessed country. And I think that's something that comes with some responsibility. And also, even if you're not motivated by a moral argument around this, which is my primary motivation, I think it's actually in the economic interests of the United States. I mean, amongst our economic challenges right now is there are literally millions more job openings in the United States at the moment than there are people looking for work. And so inviting some additional people in who want to work, which in my experience is true of the vast majority of refugees and of other immigrants, it could actually be in our own economic interest. That also, of course, grows the consumption base within the United States. And that's how you grow an economy, is a growing and not a shrinking population, which is what we would have in this country if it wasn't for our country's history of immigration.
Patrick has a comment for you, Ben.
And your guest said something about waiting 20 years for that economy to realize the things from the refugees. Well, we don't have 20 years. If we keep on doing what we're going to do, we're just going to, just like the world the World Economic Forum says, we're going to be helping everybody else and impoverishing ourselves.
Patrick Hanley.
Yeah, no, I got to disagree with you a little bit there, Ben. And Matt, I thought your answer was terrific, not only on moral, but also on economic grounds. The reality is we're a very wealthy country. And actually, Ben, I got to say your fear around the dollar, I think, is a little bit unfounded. We are the world's reserve currency. And relative to the rest of the world, we're the stablest, strongest, and now a very fast-growing economy. And so I really don't see any downside to providing fairly low amounts of assistance relative to the amount of spending that we're doing elsewhere in the economy. So I just don't see that downside.
Have you ever heard of the Great Reset?
The Great Reset? No, but if you could share.
Yeah. Okay. Look it up. It's a plan by the elite of the world to make sure that they're going to control all the economies.
Yeah.
And everything, make us poor. And everything, and they have to
I'm
do
sorry,
that.
I'm sorry, Ben. I just don't. I don't.
Who
I don't,
created this?
I don't buy into conspiracy theories like that.
All you have to do is look up the Great Reset, okay. World Economic Forum, and ESG scores.
Ben, I think we've heard a lot of conspiracy theories over the years, going back 100 years, and oftentimes they end up demonizing minorities, oftentimes Jews, and I really just don't want to dabble in that sort of stuff.
Ben, I got to tell you, you got your money's worth tonight, but we're going to move on to other subjects. And one thing I do want to say before we run out of time with Matt, there are people who are listening tonight, watching tonight, who watched all the television stories of the refugees. What can they do? Is the easiest thing for them to do to write a check? Is that the armchair response that is most valuable?
I mean, that's obviously super helpful right now, especially in terms of the humanitarian response in Europe. And people can do that at worldrelief.org. And of course, there's other good organizations that are on the ground as well. But then longer term, as we think towards the possibility of resettlement, we also depend very heavily on volunteers. And we're in about 20 different cities around the United States. But there's other resettlement agencies as well that are already receiving folks from Afghanistan and people from Burma and the Democratic Republic of Congo and other contexts, but whom we also will expect to begin to receive people from Ukraine in the coming, hopefully, weeks and months as well. And that's actually, for some people, that's a harder response. That could actually take your time. We could certainly use, financial support as well, but we also always need volunteers.
And the volunteers would basically be helping welcoming these people and preparing things that they might need to support their stay in Chicago or in the United States. That's the volunteer effort.
Yeah, so there's a whole range of options. Sometimes it's a one-time thing, like helping to set up an apartment or even being there at the airport to help welcome people. Others are, we have longer-term volunteer opportunities to make a six-month commitment that I'm going to be what we call a friendship partner or a team from a church that's a good neighbor team that will basically say, we're going to make sure we're here once a week and just have, it's basically the job description is be a friend, which is something all of us know how to do. Yeah. It means dealing with some language barriers and cultural misunderstandings often, but we can help provide some training towards those things as well.
That's a very good idea. I may take you up on it personally. That might be something to keep me busy. So thank you very much, Matt Sorens from World Relief, who joins us this evening. I'm Bruce DuMont. We will continue with Patrick Hanley and Stephanie Hitt after this break. Bruce DuMont back. We continue with Patrick Hanley and Stephanie Hitt. And Stephanie, you were going to ask, Matt is gone, but you were musing of about a question that you wish you would ask
him. Yeah, and I would love to know how nimble and easy it is for him as a private organization that, is he able to accomplish a lot of things with, his private funding and so on that makes his organization maybe more successful than some of the government organizations or some of the, the ones that are more have more red tape or, through maybe our own State Department, for example.
Yeah, they
make
rules and regulations.
Right,
yeah.
And I think what we're seeing in especially in the Afghanistan crisis that we saw a lot of that as well as Ukraine is these private organizations are really stepping up. They're finding the funding. They don't need to go to Congress to get funding. They're coming up with a lot more money.
Yeah.
And they're able to do things, gain access that maybe other, our government can't. And they're using some very creative and entrepreneurial ways to do this. And that's one thing that I think we should encourage, not just in this, but...
Are you, you know, something else I want to get reaction, because obviously the television cameras of the world are showing these very dramatic stories.
Right.
And last week, David Muir of ABC went to Ukraine, and basically all of his reporting was really about the horrendous issue of the children and the women surviving. And so that becomes a dominant media story.
Right.
It isn't about bigger, broader, you know, goals of Russia and Vladimir Putin. It's about the personal,
right?
Personal stories. Is that too much? I mean, when the recipients of American news are supposed to be digesting the bigger, broader world picture, are we sometimes seduced because media focuses on the dramatic, the traumatic, the things that the tearjerker stories that really get to everyone's heart, doesn't necessarily get to their head, and
they're the stories that we all can relate, not just relate to, but that we trust.
Yeah.
We trust when we see real human emotion.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like over these last, I don't know how many years, I'd say it's been a while, since a lot of people are not quite sure what to believe about government motives. What's the story? I mean, we just had a caller here talk about, you know, this is all part of a giant reset.
Yeah.
So the story told from that perspective is, I think, very hard for all of us to understand. And we're not sure how we're going to come down on that.
Mm-hmm.
But what we all know is that we can look at someone, we can look at a mother and her child, and we can watch these women saying goodbye to their husbands and their sons at the border. And that's something that we all understand, and we all know there's something wrong here.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
We may not know why it's wrong. We may not know who's pulling the levers. We may not really be confident in understanding the motives of Putin and what we're being told by our government or his government.
Yeah.
But the only way to really make people aware of what's going on in the world is through the personal story. I do see that. And I think a lot of people just aren't sure to trust the narrative of the bigger overarching motives.
Gosh, Stephanie, that's such a powerful point. I can't agree with you more. And I think it also speaks to the different media ecosystem that we're in now, that a lot of, especially early in the war, a lot of the videos were coming from phones, were coming through social media.
Yes,
right.
And when something takes off on social media, there's a degree of manipulation sometimes when a company or a brand does something. But when something as powerful as a video of a boyfriend hugging a girlfriend, getting on a train before he goes off to war, when that is shown to 3-4 million people who watch that video, that is a visceral human reaction. And you got to imagine that's thousands of people. Exactly. So it's such an important way to reconnect ourselves to these crises that often can seem abstract.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I think we've gotten jaded about the abstract story. We are jaded about conspiracies. We are jaded about motives.
Do you feel that you are getting a good description and complete description of what's happening, or are we and the media in the United States, are we too much on the side of Ukraine? Are we, we're taking all of their military feeds. I mean, it's a one-sided story.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, Putin is a bad guy. They're doing horrible things. But as an intelligent person who wants to devour accuracy and truth, are we getting a good dose of the other side of the story?
Well, I feel like we feel pretty confident in the Western media and the story that's being told, because we are seeing, and unless someone's got an incredible Photoshop outfit, we are seeing literally entire cities pictures of the day before and the day after.
Right.
And we are getting a sense of the reality of the absolute destruction. What is interesting is we don't know the Russian side of things.
Well, and what the Russians are doing.
You know, and how they're filtering information.
I do want to say one thing from about 35 minutes ago. I think that people may have heard me say that I was in support of nuclear war. I think you probably are shaking your heads. I didn't mean to suggest that. All I'm just saying
we have
this huge buildup. We have allegedly the greatest military in the world. Mm-hmm. We spent hundreds of billions of dollars on building our fortress, if you will. And we're fearful of the Russians and what they might do. Mm-hmm. And I just didn't want anybody to think.
But I think your point, the point that I got.
White House, take that back.
The point I got you is that, you know, there should be a healthy skepticism about his ability to do it.
Yeah. On that note, we are out of time. Our thanks to Stephanie Hitt. And also Patrick Canley for joining us, and also Matt Sorens in hour number one, and Greg Ballard in hour number one, and Matt Sorens in hour number two. Fritz Goldman, he's been here for both hours. He's awake. We'll see you next Sunday night. Good night, everybody, from Chicago.